Hi everyone, welcome to the February monthly memorial service. I hope you're doing safe and well. 皆様こんにちは。ようこそ2月の初月法要にお越しくださいましてありがとうございます。皆様それぞれ、お元気で、そしてお念仏の毎日を過ごされているというふうに、願っております。So as usual, ministers will chant a sambujo and jusege. And I'll give you a Japanese message first, and Reverend Turner will give you an English message. それではいつものように、2月に亡くなられた方々を思い出しながら、三部上そして十聖経を唱えいたします。そして続いて私の方から日本語で法話をさせていただいて、その後ターナー先生から英語の法話をいただきます。では join me 合唱 please。 ナモアミダブツナマンダブツナマンダブツナマンダブツナマンダブツナマンダブツナマンダブツナマンダブツナマンダブツ。上阿弥陀如来入道場三下落。不上釈迦如来入道場三下落。不上十方如来入道場三下落。ガシジョブンド、妙称長寿法、 空境未消門、政府上昇学、利欲人少年、上映主凡業、四愚無浄土、異性天人地、人力縁大公、不生無才路、少女三苦名、公災集約難、回避地へ現、飯困も安、閉塞小悪道、通断禅修門、高層上満足、異様老実法、日月修熟期、天候音符源、一周解放像、高性空独法、上王大集中、聖法四四苦、供養一切仏、風俗修徳本、願念心情満、得意三害を、女分無下地、通断未不詳、願学会力、投資最小尊、志願若効果、大戦王冠道、航空商店人、東内明家。ノーボンドブ、ノーボンドブ、ノーボンドブ、ノーボンドブ、ノーボンドブ、ノーボンドブ、ガンニシ平等性一切同本菩提心往生安楽南無阿弥陀仏南無阿弥陀仏南無阿弥陀仏南無阿弥陀仏南無阿弥陀仏南無阿弥陀仏南無阿弥陀仏南無阿弥陀仏南無阿弥陀仏南無阿弥陀仏南無阿弥陀仏皆様改めまして2月の初月法要にお参りいただきまして誠にありがとうございます。お元気でお暮らしのことと思っておりますねえ、コロナの人数感染者も日々と多くなっておりまして、なるべく外には行かない生活が続いておりますけれども、大変ご不便があって、そして、心配で時には寂しさを感じる毎日ではあろうかと思います。しかしこのようにお寺の方からですね、YouTube を通して、皆様とご一緒にお念仏の毎日をいたしましょう、感謝して生活していきましょうというふうにご法をさせていただきますので、どうか心をお静めになってですね、お念仏のひとときをお過ごしなさいまくつことを願っております。今日2月の初月法要で何をお話ししようかなと思っておりましたんですけれども、日本に行きますとですね、ところどころにお寺がポツポツとあります。浄土真宗のお寺もあれば禅宗のお寺もあればですね、いろんなお寺がございますけれども、その軒下にですね掲示板というね、ボーチンボードのようなものがねあるんですね。お気づきになった方ありますか？ 街を歩きながらですね、私は京都でございますけれども、まあ、京都の街を歩いていくと、京都にはやっぱりお寺が多いんですね。で、お寺のそのいわゆる掲示板にふと目が行ってですね、何が書いてあるんだろうかと見ることが時々あります。で、見て自分でふふっと笑うこともあるんですよ。で、例えばこの掲示板どんなことが書かれてるかっていうのをですね、ちょっとお話ししてみたいなと思います。まず今お見せしております掲示板、なんて書いてあるかというと、人の悪口は嘘でも面白いが、自分の悪口は本当でも腹が立つ。どうですか？これを読んだ時、私ははーっとニヤッとしました。ね、人の悪口って時々私たち言うかも分かりませんけれど、例えばあの人ね、物忘れがひどいのよとかね、なんかポッと言ってしまうことがありますけれどもね、そうかといって誰かが自分に対して、あなたもあなた物忘れひどいじゃないって言われた時にですね、私もなんとなく物忘れがひどいと思っていても、他の人から自分のその物忘れが悪いことを言われるとですね、むっと腹が立つ。みんなそうじゃないですかね、人間だったら、ね、どうしても自分のそういう非と言いますか、弱点を言われるとね、面白くない。だから腹が立つ、自分の非を認めたくないって言うんですね。ですから人の悪口は嘘でも面白い。嘘って言っても本当ではなくたくても、誰かの噂をすることは面白いいうことですね。でも自分の悪口もし言われたら、それが本当でもですよ、腹が立つっていうね。まあそんな経験ないですか？私これとっても面白いなと思いました。そしてですね、次のまあ掲示板ちょっとご覧ください。なんて書いてること言うとね、ピエンもご縁超えてご縁、ご恩ですね。ピエンもご縁超えてご恩。これ見た時に一体何の意味があるのかなと思ったんです、ね、でこれまず分からないのはピエンという意味ですね。でピエンね、あの私の京都にはいとこがおりますけれども、いとこは随分私も若いんですね。ですから SNS とかいろんなことをあのしておりましてね、で元旦早々ですね、今年もピエンかしらっていうふうにね、私に LINE で送ってきたんです。でピエンってどういうことかしらってちょっと私も調べてみました。そうするとね、ピエンっていうのはこのスクリーンでね、なんかこう目が潤んでるようなニコニコマークではないけれども、なんとなくうーんっていうふうな顔の絵がありますよね。これはピエンっていうらしいんですよ。でこれはピエンっていうのは、あの泣いている様子を示すね、擬態語ですから、ピエンっていうのはあのそういう音なんですね。ですから悲しい時とかですね、あるいは嬉しい時にもこのピエンマークは使用されるって書いてました。でもあまり深刻さは伴わないということでね、やっぱりこう気軽な意味でですね、なんとなく困ったとか心配だわとかいう時にピエンって言うらしいんですよね。ああ面白いな、これはやっぱりあのなんて流行語ですよね。で確かにこのピエンはなんか流行語大賞ですね、2019年に取ったらしいです。でこれを思うとね、ピエンもご縁っていうことは、例えばなんとなく心配の時とか悲しいとかですね、あるいは心が塞いでいる時とか、あるいはあの反対に何かいいことがあって、あ嬉しいっていうふうに思う時もピエンなんだっていうことですよね。ですからピエンもそういうご縁なんだと、いろんな原因と条件が重なったそういうご縁なんだよっていうことでしょうね。そして、その思いを超えることによってご恩を感じるんだという意味ではなかろうかと思います。でとてもこういうふうにね、このピエンもご縁超えてご恩と いう言葉をですね、考えていますとね、やっぱりお寺の掲示板に書かれてあるという意味でもですね、とても意味深いと思います。でこれやっぱりですね、すべて私に、起こる物事というものはですね、やはり仏様とのご法縁を結ぶものではなかろうかと思いますね。今こうしてずっともう約1年になろうかというコロナの問題もですね、やっぱりみんなに降りかかっている影響です。でこれもやっぱり仏様とのご縁でもあろうかと思いますね。これを通して私が生かされている毎日がどれだけ素晴らしい、ありがたいものである、今日いただいている健康がなんとありがたいものであるか、そしてこうやって手を合わせて仏様に南無阿弥陀仏を申し上げることが、なんとこれまた不思議な、そしてこれまたなんと深い深い喜びであろうかというふうに取らせていただいたらですね、私たちそれぞれが人生においていただく物事、起こるイベントというものはですね、すべて仏様のとのご縁になっていくわけです、ね、でそれによってそれを乗り越えた後にですね、それが誠に仏様からの功徳をいただいたんだと、そこに私は救われていく道を見つけることができたんだと、そしてそこにまた私は私でいいんだと納得していく道が広がっていく。そうしますと、それは本当に心からありがとう、仏法に対するありがとう、如来様へのありがとうということで、これはご恩に結びついていくということになるわけではなかろうかと思いますね。どうでしょうか。ピエンもご縁、超えてご恩。とても面白い掲示板でございますね。そしてですね、まあ最後にこれ、衆生は不安よな、阿弥陀動きます。まあどうでございますか。衆生は不安よな。衆生というのは私たち人間のこと、あるいは生きとし生けるもの、動物植物全部含みます。そういう生きとし生けるものは不安なんだと、この迷いの世界で不安な思いをしながら毎日生活しているんだということです。事実ですよね。今風邪をひいてもなかなかお医者さんに行ったり、あるいは病院で診てもらうということは難しくなっておりますね。とってもコロナのことでですね、そういうところになかなか行けない、あるいはベッドもないと言われますとね、いろんな不安が心の中によぎっております。ですから私たち生き物というのは、この迷いの世界で不安な毎日を送っているわけです。だからこそ阿弥陀動きます。阿弥陀ってどなたかというと、阿弥陀如来様のことですね。お慈悲とお知恵の、限りないお慈悲とお知恵の仏様である阿弥陀如来様が動きます。もう動いてらっしゃるということでございますね。本堂にございます阿弥陀如来様の像をですね、横からご覧にくださいましたら、阿弥陀様はね、前の方にちょっと傾いてらっしゃるんですね。少しだけですよ。その傾いてらっしゃるっていうのはですね、静かに立ってらっしゃらないという意味なんですね。もうすでに私を救うために阿弥陀如来様は動いてらっしゃるんだ、インアクションなんだと、こういうふうに浄土真宗ではいただくわけです。ですから阿弥陀様が立ったり座ったりして、ただ静かに、はい、私の時に来なさいよ、私のところの悟りの世界に来なさいよ、そのためにはあなたこれとこれとこれをしなければいけませんよっていうような仏様ではないわけです。むしろ私たちの阿弥陀如来様というのは、私の方に働きかけてくださって、私の方に自ら近づいてくださって、私に救いの道をくださる尊い仏様であると いうことでございます。そういうことで、ご本尊阿弥陀如来様は、で躍動の仏様です。もう私を救うために、そしてあなた様を救うために、もう動き、もう前にもう歩いて、あなたのところにも届いてらっしゃるわけです。ですから浄土真宗のお祈りというのは、阿弥陀様の救いは今ここに全ての人に届いているということです。ただそのことを気づくことが大事です。そうですよね。ね、これはまさにですね、私思いますのは、仏様の救い、お呼び声、南無阿弥陀仏というお声はですね、今テクノロジーで Wi-Fi を、ね、使ってますね。皆さんも Wi-Fi を使わない時がないと思います。私毎日家で、コンピューターをしている時には、必ずも Wi-Fi がなければ仕事にはなりません。 Wi-Fi は飛んでるんです。どこでも見えません、ね、形も匂いも色もありません。 Wi-Fi はね、しかしいただく、利用する私はその Wi-Fi をキャッチしなければならないわけですよね。コンピューターとか iPhone で Wi-Fi は何ですか、 Which line と聞いて、そして時々パスワードがあったらそれを入れなきゃダメですね。そこまで私たちは努力しなければいけないんです。いくら Wi-Fi がいろんなところに隅々に流れていても、この私がその Wi-Fi に気づいて、その Wi-Fi をキャッチしなければならないんですね。これはね、仏様のお救いと同じことです。南無阿弥陀仏はこの宇宙にずっと南無阿弥陀仏って響いておりますんですよ。それが気づくか気づかないか、気づかなかったらこれ残念です。ですから親鸞さんは、どうか阿弥陀様のお救い、それをどうか今ここでいただいてほしいと。我に任せよ、必ずお前を助けましょう、仏にさせて私の国に救い取りましょう、そういうお言葉ですね。そのためには、今今生この世で、この人生の中で仏法を聞いて、そして阿弥陀様の南無阿弥陀仏、我に任せよ、必ずお前を抱き取ります、そして捨てはしないという大きな大きなお慈悲に気づかされることが大事であるということでございます。そういう意味でですね、すべて私たちに降りかかる出来事というのは、阿弥陀様からのご法縁をいただくものではなかろうかと思いますね。最後に書いておりますように、念仏申し浄土へと先立って行かれた方々は、この世界に帰り来て私たちを念仏の教えに導いてくださっていますと。これは皆様が愛して、そして今日思い出して忍んでられる先立たれた方々です。その方々はお念仏を申されて仏様となられて、そして如来様の仏国である浄土の世界に行かれたんですね。そして行かれただけではございません。その後この迷いの世界に帰ってきてくださって、そしてこの私を、皆様をお念仏南無阿弥陀仏の教えに毎日導いてくださっているわけです。ですから残されている私たちは、その尊い尊い思いをいただく、そしてああありがたい、共に如来様からのお声声である南無阿弥陀仏を一緒にいただいて、そして一緒にお念仏申しましょう、そして亡き父亡き母、おじいちゃんおばあちゃん、子供さんかも分かりませんけれども、共に同じ阿弥陀様の命の中で生きていくことの喜びに感謝するわけでございます。今日は本当に 2月の正月法要にお参りいただきまして誠にありがとうございました。どうか引き続き皆様ご健康でお大事にお暮らしくださいますことを心より念じております。それでは私の方を終わらせていただきましょう。合唱いたしましょう。ナモアミダブツ、ナモアミダブツ、ナモアミダブツ、ナモアミダブツ。Now, Reverend Turner will give you an English Dharma message.
Welcome, everyone, and thank you for the introduction, Reverend Wandra, for the English Dharma talk for our February 6th Shotsuki Hoyo service. If you could please join me first in Gassho. Namo Amida Butsu, Namo Amida Butsu, Namban Da Butsu, Namban Da Butsu, Namban Da. So we have two important holidays coming up in America. One is a Valentine's Day on February 14th. And we also have an important Buddhist holiday called Nirvana Day that's observed on February 15th. So I'm speaking today on the 6th of February, and I'm also speaking at family service on Sunday, February 14th. So for February 14th, I'm going to focus on Nirvana Day, that next Monday. So today I thought it might be nice to look at Valentine's Day a little bit, and I'd like to give a Dharma talk focusing on the women of Buddhism, the feminine side, in honor of Valentine's Day. And I'm also wearing a pink Valentine's Day tie, and I'm also wearing my BWA Okesa in honoring the importance of women in the Buddhist tradition. So, you might call me as a Buddhist minister a Buddhist apologist. That doesn't mean that we apologize for Buddhism. An apologist is somebody that defends or explains or highlights the meaning of Buddhism. So when we read Buddhist texts, we often read them for their meaning. It's not the historical literalism of it, it's what it means to us. But once in a while in these stories, some real history and personality peeks through. So when you think about the Buddha's life story, we say he spent 6 years after he left home practicing before he became a Buddha at 35 under the Bodhi tree. Indian culture was never very exact on dates and duration. So something like this happened. But as a Buddhist, the 6 years is symbolic of something, that it takes a long time, it's hard. You have to practice and you have to be focused and dedicated. The other thing about the stories in Buddhism is you have to keep in mind that it's from a very patriarchal society. It's 2,500 years ago. It was very male dominant. The prince Siddhartha was also a warrior prince. He was royal. So that's kind of the double whammy. He was male. He was royal. And it was a time of patriarchy. And maybe now the fourth one is the caste system was really strong in India at this time. So I've mentioned before that I get kind of frustrated watching Masterpiece Theater on PBS. When I watch Downton Abbey and two people fall in love, but they can't be married because they're in the wrong class, that always frustrates me as an American. So England has a strong class society. India had a very strong caste society, which is even a stronger delineation of where your place is. The other thing, when they say the Buddha left home to practice in the forest, most cities were built on the edge of the woods or forested areas in a river. So it's not like he went to Yosemite. It's more like if I went to Central Park on Golden West and Talbot in Huntington Beach to practice. So I'm not too far away from home, and I'm likely to have contact with my family during my practice. So we're going to keep this in mind. So we're going to head to what happens to the Buddha's wife, Yashodhara. What's her story? We know what happens to the Buddha, the husband, but oftentimes we're not really sure what happened to the wife. And I read something once that was very moving and very personal and gives you a real sense of humanity, that the Buddha was an everyday person. We forget that the Buddha had a wife and a child and a family and relatives. And there's a set of texts called the reconciliation texts in the Buddhist tradition that present kind of their family dynamic in a very personal way. So we have three major holidays in Buddhism that I will talk about on February 14th. But we begin with the life of the Buddha as a prince. His father, King Suddhodana, a warrior king. His mother, Queen Maya, who sadly passes away on April 15th, a week after the Buddha was born, on Hanamatsuri, April 8th. And then we have his aunt, the sister of Queen Maya, Mahapajapati. She's considered to be the mother of Buddhism. She's the first nun. She began the monastic tradition for women. She's incredibly famous. So I like to talk about these women on Mother's Day. And Hanamatsuri is one of those holidays we mentioned on April 8th. At our temple, we bring out the white elephant. We roll it out from the kodo. I've done that for 20 years now, and I feel like I'm the kind of the personal keeper. I'm an elephant keeper. She has a dream about a white elephant for telling to the audience that Queen Maya is with child. And then on April 8th, the Buddha is born. And this story is one of foreshadowing. We don't really take this as literally true. We look for meaning in the symbology of it. And so this is kind of a foreshadowing of the Buddha. You could think that he was reborn as a Buddha by taking seven steps and transcending the world. And one of the things that's confusing about the story is that it says he was born from his mother's ribs. So again, if you take this literal as history, you can be mistaken. So in the Indian tradition, where you were born from on the body signaled your caste. So Brahmins, spiritual people, were born from the forehead, warriors from the ribs, merchants from the waist, laborers from the top of the feet, and untouchables from the bottom of the feet. So again, you have to really understand as a Buddhist, where is the symbols and where is the history? So the Buddha, Prince Siddhartha, lives a life of a warrior. Oftentimes we say as a prince, but he had to train. He had to protect his family. He had to learn archery, martial arts, horseback riding, negotiating, administration. He was being trained to take over the family business. That was his caste. And so here's an image of him as a warrior, as a soldier, as a prince. And then we have Prince Siddhartha marrying his wife, Princess Yasodhara. She was very beautiful. They marry, and they have a child named Rahula. So he may have been a prince, he may have been a warrior, but he also had a family. He had a wife and a newborn child, a year old, when he leaves home. So this is a picture of Rahula, perhaps around age 9. And that's an important time that we'll get to. So we have the story of Prince Siddhartha, maybe in his late 20s, going through the four gates. He sees an old man out the east gate. He sees a sick man out of the southern gate, a dying man out of the west gate, and a monk out of the north gate. And this is what sparked this aspiration to maybe find a different way to break out from his caste. And what I've read is the only way to do this in India is to leave home. You're kind of a prisoner of your birth and your household and of the situation you live in. And so to change course in your life, you literally had to leave home. You had to get yourself away from that defining environment into a new world. And so the Buddha becomes and seeks the life of a wanderer, a mendicant. And here we have a nice image of Prince Siddhartha cutting his royal hair, giving back his royal silks, his royal jewelry, and putting on the saffron robes of a spiritual wanderer. And this is his administrator, his personal servant, Chana, and his favorite horse, Kanthaka. They had a deep bond. He missed Siddhartha very much, and Siddhartha missed Kanthaka very much. So this was very difficult to do. Leaving home was hard, but it was something he was compelled to do to follow a different path in life. So he practices, as they say, for 6 years, representing a very long time. And you can kind of tell from this picture, when they say he was in the forest, he's kind of in a park. He's not in the wilderness. There are people on a walking path. There are women. So this must not be a dangerous area. And he comes upon Sujata. And this is an important woman in Buddhism. She becomes, I think, the first female follower of the Buddha after his enlightenment. And she offers him a bowl of sweetened milk. I always tell people it might be like getting a vanilla milkshake after being ascetic for 6 years. And so he gathers his strength. He sits on this bed of grass, and early in the morning, under the Bodhi tree, the Buddha realizes awakening or nirvana. And so this took 6 years. So he left home when Rahula was 1. Rahula would be 7 right now. And 2 years later, we find that he returns home to reconcile with his family in a formal way. At least this is when the story is set. So now, rather than the life of a wanderer, we have the life of a Buddha. And how does a Buddha, who still has a wife and child, what is that dynamic and how does that work? And so here's an image of the Buddha returning home to his father, maybe Mahapajapati, Rahula, and Yoshidhara. And so I wanted to read you this essay. I didn't know this, but Yoshidhara also had a nickname of Bimba. And it would be interesting to track this down. Her name was Bimba. And then this article is called Bimba's Lament. It was hard to be away from her husband. It was hard. She missed him. And it was difficult. And there's a wonderful, very personal reconciliation between the Buddha and all of his family members from his hometown where he grew up. And many of them actually followed him and became part of the Buddhist monastic tradition. They became monks and nuns. And there were so many relatives being ordained that later they actually made a rule in the monastic code that you weren't allowed to ordain a family member because this was kind of everybody was joining the Buddhist Sangha. So it says here, it was the first time Yoshidhara, referred to as Bimba in some of the Pali commentaries, had seen her husband since his renunciation of the householder life. Bimba's lament occurs within a series of conversion stories following Prince Siddhartha's enlightenment as the Buddha. The Kapilavastu cycle includes the conversion of the Buddha's relatives, his father, his wife, and his son. Even though the conversions are central to the Buddha's career and the early development of the Sangha, the episode also brings to life the realistic human feelings concerning Siddhartha's renunciation. Bimba's natural resentment at being deserted by her husband, the disappointment felt by Bimba and Suddhodana, the Buddha's father, at Siddhartha's decision to reject the privileges and prestige of kinship. It has the ring of historical reality. The legend seems to reach out towards history. Furthermore, in the light of the patriarchal background of the text composition, the unknown author, most certainly a monk, should be applauded for his sensitivity to the plight of a royal wife by her husband. He experienced the same sort of happiness as he had known 8 years earlier when he had departed. Bimba, the mother of Rahula, hearing the loud noises and excitement of the people, asked her ladies-in-waiting, "O attendants, what is it I hear? What is happening?" Her servants replied with respect, "O queen, you hear no ordinary noise. It is the return of the king's son, your husband. At this very moment, he is going barefoot on his alms round throughout the city." When Bimba heard the news, she covered her face with her scarf and sobbed uncontrollably, her heart filled with pain. "Now he has discarded all signs of his royal status. Such behavior brings disgrace upon me as a royal princess. Being a wife without a husband is a sorrowful state. I have been deserted and I am bereft of merit. I was once beautiful, but now an ugly hag." When Bimba regained her composure, she went to the window where she beheld the handsome form of the Buddha radiating the splendor of his enlightenment. She was transformed by his beauty. She turned to her son Rahula and said, "O child, look at your father. Now you know how handsome he is. His eyes are round and beautiful like those of a calf." Bimba, knowing that the Buddha had gone many places on his alms rounds, exclaimed, "I am upset and brokenhearted that Rahula's father behaved in this dishonorable way." Suddhodana was likewise troubled that the Buddha's extensive alms tours would prompt gossip and reproach. On the first day, at the conclusion of the Buddha's sermon, the king reached the stage of stream enterer. On the second day, at the end of the sermon, his stepmother reached the stage of stream enterer. The king also listened attentively to the sermon and attained the state of once returner. On the third day, Suddhodana attained the state of never returner. Then King Suddhodana, looking at the assembled female attendants and not seeing his daughter-in-law Bimba, told his maid, "Go to Bimba. Tell her that her father wants her at the palace. The Buddha himself has entered the palace and extended his blessings to his father, stepmother, Bimba, and Rahula, from whom he has been separated for 7 years. The Buddha has returned in order to console us, wipe our tears with his sermons." The Buddha entered with Sariputra and Moggallana. "If Bimba receives me by massaging my feet with her soft hands, out of her compassion toward me, the two of you should not stop her from doing this." Bimba suddenly felt hot and short of breath. Upon seeing the Buddha, she felt angry and resentful. "Why do I cry? I am angry because my husband has not even greeted me. We were married for only 7 years and he abandoned me. I was still young. It was not as though my Lord was leaving me in his old age. I felt very lonely." Bimba's attendants, unable to relieve her sorrow, wept with her. The king told the Buddha that Bimba loves you very much. She cried continually after you left at midnight. Bimba's sorrow gradually disappeared. She listened to the Buddha's teachings and attained stream enterer. Rahula was ordained by the Buddha into the Sangha. After 5 years, the Buddha had 500 disciples. Before the king dies, he gains arhatship after reflecting on the Buddha's teachings of the Four Noble Truths. Gotami, Mahapajapati, the Buddha's aunt, and his wife, Bimba, join the Buddha's order along with various other Sakyan officials. The text concludes with the transcriber of the text wishing the highest happiness of nirvana to his family, teachers, and all living beings. So, Buddhist scholars have said that this sounds realistic. It sounds historically true that personality is coming through the mist of history towards us, not as myth, but as real family emotion, real human emotion between husband and wife and father and son. You can tell that they felt that their way of life, the warrior caste, he had rejected. And they took that very personally. But in these reconciliation texts, it's kind of interesting. They're converted. They begin to drift away from the warrior caste and begin to see a new way of life. Rahula becomes a monk. Yoshidhara becomes a nun. Mahapajapati, the Buddha's aunt, she becomes and begins the monastic tradition for women. And so this kind of puts a conclusion to the story We get our happy ending in a sense. He converts his family to his way of thinking. And these four states, stream enterer, never returner, once returner, these are like the Bodhisattva stages in Mahayana Buddhism. So for the Buddha's father to reach arhatship before he passes away echoes to me a little bit like realizing the Pure Land as one dies. And so, you know, the Buddha's father actually realizes nirvana at death. He's, to me, the first one in the text I've seen to do this, even before the historical Buddha. So he actually changes the caste of all those of his loved ones. They see him and the sincerity of his practice and the authenticity of the way, and it no longer is a personal affront, but a calling, a new way of living. They begin to see the world through the eyes of the Buddha, and their personal slights and hurts and quibbles dissolve away, and they all become part of the Buddhist tradition. And this last little closing epitaph that, you know, this was written most likely by a male monk. So patriarchy is also being challenged in the Buddhist tradition. This is a very understanding, gentle, compassionate storytelling of how it would feel if, like, for instance, my family, suddenly I don't want to be a programmer anymore. I want to go to IBS. I want to retire early and become a full-time minister. That's kind of a big deal. What about the family finances? What about retirement? What about healthcare? And so, you know, my family supported me and they understood that this was something that I had to do. It's not really a choice. We're often compelled to follow the way. And luckily for me, my bimba was right by my side. My son and daughter came to the church with me. I was able to bring my family across the river into the forest, into the Orange County Buddhist Temple, because we practice as everyday Buddhists. We are so lucky that we don't have to choose between family and Buddhism. And I think here we're seeing signs of the Buddha as still a family man. I entitled this The Buddha's Wife because we don't really think of it that way. He still had family relationships that he had to navigate. He had a son that was a monk now, and there was probably gossip between the monks about nepotism, playing favorites to one's relatives, letting Mahapajapati start the female monastic tradition just because she was your stepmother. There was probably all kinds of issues like this that the Buddha had to navigate. So we think of him as a monastic, but monasticism is not a full-time job. You go in and out of the monastery, especially during the rainy season. So this is another thing that's not well understood. When it's raining and pouring in India, you kind of hold up in the monastery and practice. But when the weather changes, you go back out amongst the people and you give Dharma talks and you go on your begging rounds and you connect with people. And the Buddha did that very much so. So I think this black and white monastic versus everyday practice is kind of punctured here with this type of story. And it's a very happy story. It's a reconciliation. It's a conversion between the Buddha and his family. And lots of people from his hometown followed him into the Buddhist way and to practice the Buddha Dharma throughout their lives. So I hope we can carry this tradition on Valentine's Day, appreciate our wives and husbands and children that make it possible for us to practice. I've heard ministers say that it's very difficult to practice Buddhism if you're the only one in the family. It really helps to have your family by your side and to practice within the family dynamic and within the home and not just Sunday mornings at the Orange County Buddhist Church or the Vista Buddhist Temple. So happy Valentine's Day, and thank you for all the mothers and daughters and sisters that have been able to join the tradition and make it so much more meaningful and keeping us on the straight and narrow. Thank you very much. Please join me in Gassho. Namo Amida Butsu, Namo Amida Butsu, Namo Amida Butsu, Namo Amida Butsu. So thank you very much for coming to February Shotsuki Hoyo. We will see you again in March for our monthly memorial service. Thank you very much.